centuries, we have dined in our ears that man is a miserable sinner, a frail mortal prone to error and sin, a weakling whose nature is corrupt and base. These disparaging assertions originated in the fallacy theory that man is a product of matter. Human nature is God nature, and as such it needs to be respected, for never before his original divinity to be so doubted, and its divinity or dignity so debased. Since human nature resists all efforts at modification and alteration, it is useless to legislate towards uniformity, to require man to be what they are not. Laws which depend upon compulsion instead of persuasion or education never worked. Those which aim at regimentation likewise miscarry. Human differences, dissimilar capacities, ideas, and talents must be recognized. Those most successful governments are those which permit and encourage men to develop their basic differences. Human beings were created unlike, and the more they unfold, the more will they differ. Their innate unlikeness cannot be eradicated, but it can and should be developed. Compulsory conformity in all respects is contrary to man's nature and induces him to break those laws that restrict his freedom of expression and action. The masses must someday awaken from their stupor and begin to think. Thought is, of course, about the last thing rulers encourage. Their ambition is to eliminate it altogether. Every man unfolds a distinct character over which circumstances and education have only the most limited control. No two people will ever draw the same conclusion from the same experience, but each must interpret events and fit them into the mosaic of his own life's pattern. Human nature is ever true to itself, not to systems of faith or education. Each holds to the structure of the mold in which the soul can cast at the time of its individuation. The qualities born in each one remains as potentials, whether they have a chance to develop or not. Under pressure or change of interest, they can partially or wholly disappear from view for considerable periods of time. But nothing can permanently modify them, nothing can obliterate them. The constancy of human nature is proverbial. As no one believes that a man can fundamentally change his nature. This is why it is so difficult for one who has acquired an unsavory reputation to reestablish himself in public confidence. People know from experience that an individual who in one year displays knavish characteristics seldom in the next becomes any different. Nor does a thief become a trustworthy employee, or a miser, a philanthropist. Nor does a man change and become a liar, coward, or traitor at 50 or 60 if he is one reads of men saving others at the peril of his own lives. One plunges into the surf and rescues a swimmer from drowning. Another dashes into a burning house and carries a stranger to safety. Others snatch a child from the wheels of death. Many give their blood that others may live. Not only the Nazarene, but countless unnamed and unrecorded men have given their lives for their fellow men. Not only in the battlefront, but in the home front as well. We care not how outwardly base and cruel a man may appear to be. There is a valuable spot within every man. This is a spark of divinity which must be appealed to. Some will deny man's divinity, especially in times of war. True, today many men have reverted to a stage lower than savage, but this is the result of coercion. They would have shunned such action if left to themselves. Whenever stupid rulers agree, they commit conspiracies against mankind and cunningly incite them to murder one another. It is true today, as in the time of Carlyle, the author of the statement. If people had access to truth, wars would be impossible. But truth would never be available so long as governments control the news and its sources. The tragedy of it. Men are capable of so much heroism, nobility, generosity, and kindness. But leaders who should encourage this conduct incite them to fly at each other's throats like mad dogs. The reports of psychiatrists prove that murderers or murder is a violation of human nature. During World War I, one-third of all casualties were mental disorders. 34,000 mentally disabled veterans from previous wars are still in government hospitals, costing to the date more than $1 billion. It is still too soon to count the victims of the recent slaughter, but the number will far exceed those of previous wars. Now another carnival of carnage is halted. The last shot is fired for some people. But the war is not over for these hundreds of thousands of the insane and shell-shocked victims who are still in their world of hell, secluded from the public, forgotten and neglected by the politicians and the for-profit privateers in some respects. Human nature does not and cannot change, but unfolds its inherent pattern in the loom of the eternal time. All created things fulfill their destiny and the purpose for which they